set out a box in the back of the sanctuary, provided pink question forms, and asked you in the congregation to pose questions that I will try to answer that will inform the content of this morning's sermon. Before I get to your questions, I want to begin just by saying a little bit about this exercise. The asking of questions, I mean, the asking of big religious questions is one of the ways in which we grow that free mind of which Channing spoke. I call that mind free, which jealously guards its intellectual rights and powers and does not content itself with a passive or hereditary faith, which opens itself to light whensoever it may come and receives new truth as an angel from heaven. The other thing I want to say about this sermon is that it is an exercise, as it is every week, but especially this week, an exercise in the freedom of the pulpit and the freedom of the pew. The freedom of the pulpit is one of the cornerstones of Unitarian Universalist tradition, and it means simply this. In our tradition, when you call a minister, you call that minister to speak the truth as they see it, according to the dictates of their conscience and without fear or favor. It's actually in my letter of agreement with the church. It says that I am to speak without fear or favor. Without fear, I should not change one word of what my conscience tells me to say out of fear of repercussions. And without favor, I should not change what I say out of interest in personal gain. True story, I once had a parishioner try to bribe me. Actually, to try to buy me off, offered to pay me not to speak on a particular subject. I told him to hit the bricks. In fact, the freedom of the pulpit is so sacrosanct in Unitarian Universalism that failing to zealously defend the freedom of the pulpit is considered a form of ministerial malpractice. And the freedom of the pew is the corollary to the freedom of the pulpit. The freedom of the pew is this. It's first of all, it's your ability to trust that what I say is spoken from the depths of my convictions as best as I am able, and is not being said because I've been bullied or bought off. Your freedom of worship is tied to the freedom of the pulpit. And the freedom of the pew is also this. It's also your right to think differently than I think. My words may be passionate, they may come from, 7 years of education in religious studies and theology and ministry and 15 years of practice in ministry, but the freedom of the pew is your freedom, which you always carry with you, to disagree with anything or with everything that I say. In total, I received some 48 questions from the congregation. And now I have to tell you, you asked some wonderful questions. Many of the questions that you asked are deserving of an entire sermon. Some are deserving of an entire series of sermons. But it's not my plan to keep us here till Tuesday. I don't think you want to be here till Tuesday. I don't want to be here till Tuesday. So that means that there are a whole bunch of your questions that I won't answer. As one of my mentors once put it, ministry is the art of disappointing people at a rate they can tolerate. So, in case you're wondering, I just want to talk about the questions before I get into a few of them. Here's how the 48 questions broke down. The largest grouping of questions, nearly a quarter of the questions asked, were people asking me personal questions. Everything from my favorite color, orange, to my favorite music, to my guilty pleasures, I'm actually pretty boring, to my own personal theology and spiritual practices. But there were also some recurring themes to the others. Multiple people asked questions about forgiveness. Several people asked questions about the meaning of suffering. A number of people asked questions about the theological problem of evil. And the second largest grouping of questions, by far the second largest, were variations on the question of how to live within the moral atrocity of our American political crisis without giving in to despair. That was the second largest grouping of questions. Not all questions were so serious. On the lighter side, two different people asked questions about why those of us who lead worship wear what we wear on Sunday mornings. Two questions. And our minister emeritus, Charlie Cast, left a signed note in the box asking, "What is the meaning of life?" Charlie has a preaching day coming up in September, so I'll save that one for a good answer then. Fascinating. Here's one question that I had to kind of wrestle with a little bit. Here, let me read the question in its entirety. Quote, "My mother-in-law is a devout Christian who suffers from anxiety and has been hospitalized twice for it. She worries about our family because we do not go to a traditional Christian church. I have skirted around conversations with her about my true beliefs. I believe that we're all children of God, but I don't believe in the Trinity and salvation through Jesus. I fear telling her this might send her over the edge. So instead, I gloss over my beliefs and let her believe I am a Christian. I feel like a liar. What should I do?" Good question. That sounds like, I want to acknowledge, first of all, that's an uncomfortable place to be. And to the person who wrote this question, I want you to know that you're certainly not the only person in this congregation who experiences tension within their family over religious differences, or whose parents wished that you were different in some way, whether that's religiously different or politically different, or a different kind of parenter, or that you lived your life in a different way. So here's a couple of thoughts. First of all, I'm curious about whether you think this anxiety is driven by her religious views, or if the anxiety is somehow deeper and is just expressing itself conveniently through her religious views. Which is to say, I'm not sure that it is a tension that can ever be resolved through theological debate, by which it means it probably wouldn't do you any good for you to engage your mother in a theological debate on the finer points of soteriology. I don't think that will get you where you want to go. There's also, though, on the other hand, a school of thought that says it's a mistake for us to take responsibility for another person's anxiety. That fundamentally, people are responsible for regulating their own anxiety, and it isn't healthy for us to feel responsible for managing someone else's anxiety. In fact, the school of thought says the more we react to anxiety in any relationship, the more we invite anxiety in that relationship. And so that school of thought would call for perhaps taking a self-differentiated, here I am, and that's a possibility. And finally, I don't think that you should feel like a liar. There's this story that I like, the story about Daniel Handler, an author who writes offbeat books for children under the nom de plume Lemony Snicket. And he was once asked by Terry Gross, "Have you run into any parents, teachers, or librarians who object to either the tone or the content of your books?" And Handler offered this response. He said, "Not as nearly as many as I thought I would. There have been just a few isolated complaints that I've heard. A woman once in Oregon came up to me at a bookstore and said, 'You know, in one of your books, you teach that it's sometimes necessary to lie. And that seems like a very disturbing lesson to me. Can you name a time, Daniel Handler, when it would be absolutely necessary to lie?' And Handler replies, 'And I was so happy that the answer came to me right away, instead of, you know, as it usually does, when people say something to you and you think 3 days later, oh, that's what I should have said. Instead, it came right away, and I was able to just turn to her and say, nice sweater.'" And I was really proud of that. So I think that what Lemony is saying here is that our world sometimes runs on us not saying every single thing that we happen to be thinking all of the time. Right? That our world sometimes runs by us not saying everything that we happen to be saying, happen to be thinking all the time. I did ask someone I know who struggles with how to make interactions with her parents healthier what she does when she goes to visit. And what she recommended was taking charge of planning encounters. She and her parents decide on books they will read together, and their visits are spent discussing the book. It's like a parent-child book club. And the person I know says, by setting those boundaries with her parents, the conversation is steered away from going in an unhealthy direction. They sort of decide ahead of time, we can talk about this book and play bridge or whatever it is, and that actually sets a good boundary around the visit. Another person wrote this: openness and love require trust and vulnerability. How should people navigate openness and love when or after trust is betrayed? What is the best way to keep firm boundaries while keeping one's heart open? How should people navigate abusive relationships and or mental illness and others that can lead to pain, while also holding true to the inherent dignity of every person? To these questions, I want to just first say that every person, without exception, has a right to live free from abuse. That every person, without exception, has a right to live free from abuse. And if you are being abused, what I would strongly encourage is to put appropriate distance between yourself and the person who is behaving abusively. The phrase inherent worth and dignity from our first UU principle, I think, is actually misunderstood in problematic ways. The phrase is used all the time to refuse to hold people accountable for behaviors that are harmful. But the truth is, we honor people's worth and dignity by holding them accountable and by refusing to allow them to hurt people or to hurt us. There are times when the most caring thing that we can do for another person is not to allow them to harm us or harm others. Because when they harm us or harm others, they are actually acting beneath their worth and dignity. Let me say that again. There are times when the most caring thing we can do for another person is not to allow them to harm us or harm others, because when they harm us or harm others, they are actually acting beneath their worth and dignity. For example, and this is kind of an extreme example, as a church, we have a disruptive behavior policy that at its extreme allows us to either conditionally or even permanently require someone to leave the community if they are behaving in pervasively harmful ways. And it's there because there are times when the most caring thing that we can do for a person is to refuse to allow them to hurt others. The questions this person asked also mentions mental illness, which makes it a whole lot harder and a whole lot sadder. I would just say quickly that I know that having a loved one with mental illness is something a lot of people in this church face. Having a loved one with mental illness is something that a lot of people in this church face, and that one of the tragic, broken things in our society is that family often winds up being the only resource for those with mental illness, and that makes it extremely hard on the family, and I think that's a sign of systemic brokenness. And that as hard as that is, I've known families who've struggled with it and come to all different conclusions, including families in this church who have set strict boundaries for their own protection. It is a hard, but sometimes necessary thing to do. And for that question of trust, there is, I think, There's an existential quality to that. There's no way to trust someone with 100% certainty that your trust will never be betrayed. There's no such thing, just as there's no such thing in our world as 100% safety or 100% security. What I think you can do with someone who you're trying to grow in trust with is to really be honest with that other person about times in your life when your trust was betrayed, to tell that other person that it may take you a while to develop trust, and to let another person earn your trust by respecting the boundaries that you set. And I say that like it's easy, but there is nothing at all easy about it. There's nothing at all easy about it. I'm gonna run through quickly through a number of questions that could probably get longer answers. I received two questions about forgiveness. One was straight and to the point. It said, forgiveness, how? Question mark. And another person wrote, how does a non-religious person feel forgiveness? How does a non-religious person feel forgiveness? Which I thought was an interesting question. Because that puts forgiveness in this sort of scale of religion where it's through one's own religiosity, perhaps through one's faith in God, that one encounters forgiveness. And it seems that you can imagine forgiveness as coming from God, but that a non-religious person can imagine forgiveness as coming from within themselves, and forgiveness can also occur across relationships. Forgiveness can occur between you and me. So how does a non-religious person feel forgiveness? Possibly by feeling forgiveness within themselves or with in the relationship with the person they're in a relationship that needs forgiveness with. The question of how to forgive is a hard one. I preach on forgiveness every single year. It's one of the, I always preach a sermon on forgiveness in either September or October. And it's because when I come back from summer vacation in August, I come back with all sorts of great ideas, and with this determination to do everything right. And then by the beginning of September, I've already messed that up, and there's already people I need to ask for forgiveness. And I preach on forgiveness, annually for 15 years, and I still struggle with the question how. But there's two thoughts about forgiveness that actually I like. One is that forgiveness can be a gift that we give to ourselves, recognizing that if we are kind of walking around carrying grudges, it might actually impact our own life in a more negative way. And so that forgiveness can actually be a gift that we give to ourselves in order to carry through life a little better. And then another person said, I don't know who said it, but he said, forgiveness is the act of giving up on the idea that yesterday could be different. Forgiveness is the act of giving up on the idea that yesterday could be different, which is basically that yesterday is what it was, and from now on I'm going to move forward. But forgiveness is hard. Let's see what other questions we got here. So one person asked, what is the tradition of wearing stoles, which nobody's wearing this morning, but stoles are those garments that sort of hang over your shoulders. What is the tradition of wearing stoles by the choir and ministers? Please explain this tradition. Can guest speakers, lay preachers, or guest musicians wear stoles? And I think this is just a fascinating question. because nobody knows for sure what the origins are, although kind of wearing fancy religious garb seems to be an ancient tradition. Some people think it goes back to Jewish prayer shawls. Other people think it goes back to a cloth that Jesus wore for washing the disciples' feet. Others think it goes back to when the Christian church merged with the state in Rome, that ministers actually, that it was a political thing that one wear, and one actually put it on to symbolize your kind of belonging to empire. So the tradition is that nobody knows. All I know is that for a long time, Unitarian Universalists didn't, until there was a group of Universalist ministers in the 1960s, I believe, whose idea were to say, we should bring back some rites and rituals and garments. And they started putting stoles on people, and then Unitarians started wearing them. In some traditions, it's seen as a sign of ordination. It's seen as actually like a yoke of responsibility that ordination conveys that one wears. But there are actually no rules about it. The only rules are the rules that we create, and I don't mind when the worship associate wears them or when the choir wears it. I don't need to set rules on clothing. Although I will tell you, is this interesting at all?
Yes.
So when I graduated from seminary, the church where I was a student minister bought me as an end-of-the-year gift, as a graduation gift, they bought me a Harvard gown, like a full preaching robe gown, $625 was what it costs for one of these, and had like the fancy Harvard insignia on it. And so I went in and told the person giving out the gowns, Master of Divinity, that's just what it's for a Master of Divinity, and they looked it up in their book and gave me this gown. And the gown had the three chevrons on the side, which are usually a sign in academic regalia of like a doctor. And so I asked him, is this right? And the person was like, according to our like manual of proper academic regalia, the Master of Divinity is a terminal degree, therefore you wear the three sides. And I get to graduation, and half of the people are wearing robes with the three things, and half aren't in the Master of Divinity class. So it seems like everybody was given a different robe. And so I talked to different people, and people said, no, you should wear that robe, or you shouldn't. Some people said, no, it's only for people with a PhD, is the three chevrons. And other people said, no, the Master of Divinity is a terminal degree, so you get the chevrons. And then I moved, so I went through my ministry wearing this robe, and then I got here, and when I showed up in an academic community where so many people have a PhD, I thought, what if I wear this robe? And like, someone calls me on it. And so I actually, in my office, I attempted to perform microsurgery on the robe. And that didn't work. And so there's a black Harvard robe hanging up in one of the closets in the church with these holes on the sleeves. And I say this because I'm often, you know, there is no formal rule. The rules of this are not written down anywhere. And so that's my story about that. And one person wrote, the other person who wrote about clothing said, I love this. This is true. You're always the best dressed member of our congregation. What inspires you? Signed a casual Sunday. Thanks. Do the David Letterman thing. But finally, and then I'm going to the end here. One person wrote, what is it about this community that attracts and holds such great staff in great numbers? And I love that question. That's kind of the question that I just want to end on using with you for a few moments, because I really do think, as a church, we've got a great thing going. That there's an energy to this place. There is a laughter to this place. I enjoy it. I come in every day, and I'm really grateful for a staff who, from every single one of them, actually loves church and wants to be here. Like, that's the number one basic. If you're going to work for a church, you actually have to like church. And some people decide to go work for a church and actually don't like church. But all of our staff like church and want to be here and are so generous with their talents and their time and their energy. And that's one of the greatest joys, is getting to work with a fantastic staff. And the congregation, who wants to be here and enjoys coming and enjoys being with each other and enjoys the fellowship, the justice work, the service, the learning, the meditating, the singing that we do. I could probably come up with a better answer than that, but I think that it's actually very basic, that the people who come here love it, want it to be healthy and good, and for that I am grateful. And with that answer, I will say amen, and let's move to the end of the service. Our closing hymn this morning is number 128, "For All That Is Our Life," and I invite you to rise and sing out.